Doctor, shall we start?
Yes. Let me start.
Yes, sir, please.
I am not there. You are getting me.
Should I start?
Yes, sir.
Good morning, everybody. I welcome all the participants in this technical session too. I welcome my co-chairperson Jastur Sahib. I'm also welcoming reporter Ms. Palvinder Kaur. I think all the participants have not reached to this. Whether Surbhi Bansal is available?
Yes.
Surbhi?
Yes, sir.
Am I able?
Yes.
So you continue, yes, with your presentation.
Shall I share my screen?
Hello?
So shall I share my screen?
Please speak loudly, a bit loud.
Share my screen?
Yes, yes. You start with your paper. Cost and return structure of wheat crop.
Yes, under
tenant farmers in Punjab.
Yes, sir. Good morning, everyone. Today I am here to present my paper entitled with cost and return structure of wheat crop under tenant farming in Punjab, a field survey. Agriculture development in Indian economy largely depend upon the existing man and land relationship. Land leasing is one of the earliest form of production organization in agriculture, still a matter of considerable importance in present agriculture. To regulate farming, a model of land leasing act 2016 is being formulated by Niti Aayog to strike a balance between the interest of owner and the tenant farmer. This will ensure that the tenant farmer get institutional credit beside insurance and other benefit at par with the landowner. The ever escalating input cost coupled with stagnant agriculture productivity has resulted into decline in farm profitability over the year, has become the major concern for the farmer as well as the policymakers. In such a situation, it become imperative to study how the tenant farmer especially survive in farming and how they cope up in the present scenario of agricultural crisis in the state. Objectives: to study the cost return structure of wheat crop based on various costs between tenant and owner farmers, and examine the net returns and profitability between tenant and owner farmers for wheat crop in different zones of Punjab. The primary data has been collected through the multi-state random sampling technique in Punjab stage. At first stage, one district is selected from each agroclimatic zone. At second stage, two blocks were selected from each selected district. And third stage, two or four villages were selected from each selected block. At last stage, 10 tenant farmers were selected from each selected village and making a sample of 120 farmers. And to make the comparative analysis, owner farmers were selected with same socioeconomic profiles and making a sample of 60 owner farmers. Thus, the study was based on 180 farmers, in which 120 are the tenant and 60 were the owner farmers. For the analysis purpose, cost concept used by CACP were used. Result and discussion. Cost from wheat crop based on various cost concept. The table depicts that all the cost concept were comparatively higher in case of owner farmer as compared to tenant farmers, except cost A2, because A2 costs include the rental value of leasing land, and the proportion of A2 cost from the C2 cost was 93% in case of tenant farmers and just 29% in case of owner farmers. In case of total cost, the total cost was 77 was 60.77%, which was quite higher as compared to owner farmer, that is 12.6, which clearly depict that the tanner farmers were more efficient in using
most credit ghost team
as compared to owner farmers. The conclusion: the cost events was reported less in tanner farmers, which clearly depict that the tanner farmer efficiently used the inputs and even its returns was also comparatively high in case of tanner farmers, which show the famous quote, money saved is money earned. The study highlighted that the cost A2 of wheat cultivation was comparatively higher in case of tanner farmer as compared to owner farmers because it includes the rental value of leasing land. The total cost of cultivation was also observed to be lower in case of tanner farmers as compared to owner farmer, resulting in high profitability in tanner farmer in relation to owner farmer. From the study, it was concluded that the government may ensure an adequate size of holding, that is, operational land holding should be distributed uniformly among all the farm groups on the account of providing sustainable income and livelihood to all the farmers. Thank you.
You have well presented that there is a difference between the cost of the tenants as well as the owner farmer. So thank you very much for your presentation. I think you are to act as reporter board in Grover Sabs.
Yes, sir. So
you can be and go there.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Now I invite this Harinder Pratap Singh Chaudhary, Supriya GP Singh, Pavan Kumar Singh, and P. Mishra, who would be presenting. Who would be presenting?
Hello. Hello.
Harinder Pratap Singh.
Yes. Good morning, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Supriya GP Singh, okay. Yes. Yes, you present your
Hello.
Paper. Hello, hello, Supriya. Hello. Supriya, are you ready? So far, Supriya takes the time to start. Let I invite the second presenter, Abhijit Das and Bhupinder.
Hello, sir. Yes, sir. I am Abhijit Das. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, audible.
Okay, I will share my screen now.
Okay.
Sir, whether screen is coming or not, sir? Hello. Hello. Sir, screen is coming or not, sir? Hello. Hello, sir.
Yes. You start.
Sir, is it visible, sir?
No, yes, PPT is not visible. Actually, only your folder is visible.
Okay, PPT, yes, is not visible yet. PPT is not visible, sir.
Yeah, no. You have minimized the PPT. Maximize it. Only your folder is visible. You have minimized the PPT, I think.
Now is it coming, sir?
Your voice is clear, but PPT is not showing on the screen. This PPT, I think.
No, sir.
Or it is not open, I think.
Hanji, sir.
Now is it coming, sir?
Visible.
Okay, sir. Fine. Now slides are there, no, sir?
Yes, start.
Okay, good morning, everyone. My name is Arjit Das. I am from ICAR National Education Institute, Karnal, Haryana. Today, I am here to present my seminar on appraisal of agribusiness industries in India and their market growth scenario. First of all,
either you make full volume of your speaker or you speak loudly.
Okay, sir. Okay. So coming to the contents of my slides, first it will come introduction, second methodology, after the results and discussion, and in this session, dairy industry, jute industry, cotton industry, tea industry, coffee industry, and at last conclusions. Now coming to introduction, now agribusiness comprises several components such as production, processing, marketing, and export and import of agricultural produce and allied sectors such as horticulture, fishery, livestock, etc. Means comprises many sectors. The term agribusiness industry includes not only farm itself but also entire chain of agriculture related business, includes seed supply, food processing, and machineries. The development of agribusiness industries in India commenced during pre-independence days. The food processing industry has been started and accelerated growth. It is projected to be a futuristic industry, and it is anticipated that over the years it will emerge as the leading player in the global markets. The main objective of the study is to showcase the past and future demands of several agro-based and allied industries such as dairy industry, jute industry, cotton industry, tea industry, coffee industry, and its contribution to the changing pattern of agribusiness in India. Now coming to methodology, secondary data are collected from CIER, the Center of Industry and Economic Research, and Ministry of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare. The growth rate is calculated by Cobb Douglas production function, which is Y is equal A, B to the power T. Now coming to results and discussion. This table showcases the demand of dairy, jute, cotton, tea, and coffee industries product. From this table, actually this is a single table. I split it in two parts. From this table, you can see that the demand of this all products increasing trend, and maximum demand of this product in India will be highest will be in future, that is 2024 and 25. This was predicted by CIER. This demand was predicted by CIER. Now coming to second table, growth rates of dairy, jute, cotton, tea and coffee industry. From this table, we can see that in dairy industry, highest growth rate, that was 7.7%, was found in 2005. In jute industry, the highest growth rate was found in the session 10 to 19, and in cotton industry, the highest growth rate was found in 10 to 19, and tea industry, the highest growth rate was found 2005, 2006, and 2010, 2011. For coffee industry, the highest growth rate was found in 2019. Highest growth rate will be found in 1920 and 2425. Now, from this graph, see the representation of the growth rate. You can see that 2001, 2005, 2006 are good for the agribusiness industries in India. It's having negative growth rate, but the past growth rates were good. 1990 and 2000, 2001 growth rates were good, and the future growth rates also good. Now coming to dairy industry, means dairy whiteners. Here I am concerning about the dried dairy products. And coming to market growth rate is decreasing from sub period 2000-2005, but demand for the products will increase heavily. In future, the table, it is table, it was highly significant during 2000 and 2005. For fulfilling this tremendous demand, the dairy whiteners industry market need to be grow at a faster rate. Next, coming to jute industry. Now, jute industry is one of the important market components of Indian market scenario. For the sub period 2000 to 2011, the growth rate was negative, but it was not statistically significant, and maximum growth rate can be seen in sub period 2010 to 2019, which was statistically significant at 5% level of probability. Plastic bags create harm to the environment. For getting rid of this harm, related products with near future, and the market growth rate should be 2019 in sub period 2000 to 2005. The demand for cotton fabric in its during 1990, the demand was only 3.43 billion square meter, and now around 52.1 million square meter. It has been stated that the demand billion square meter in 2024-25, which is almost four times more than compared to 1990. Market growth rate also showed positive trend. Now coming to tea industry, the overall demand for tea industry increasing trend, except for the year 2005, 2008, 2010, 2014. Market growth rate shows positive trend, except for the sub period 2000 and 2005. By looking at the increasing trend of demand in near future, the positive growth rate of tea market is quite satisfying. Now coming to the last industry, it is coffee industry. It revealed that the future, that is 2024-25, demand of coffee is 665,000 metric tons, which is almost four times better than the past demand. Market growth rate shows that highest growth rate will be take place on sub period 1920-24-25. On sub period 2000-2005, market growth rate was negative. Then mean by looking at the positive market growth rate, it can be assumed that the future demand can be satisfied. Now coming to conclusion, now after analyzing all these industries, it is clear that both demand and market growth rate is positive throughout the all sub period, except for the jute, tea and coffee industry, where in some sub periods negative market growth rate was found. First demand of industry's products was very low as compared to the future demand. This increasing demand with positive market growth rate will create a better marketing environment for agribusiness industry's products. Due to this increasing demand, the number of suppliers will increase, and this will lead to competition between suppliers, which will ultimately give benefit to the consumer. So we can say that we can conclude that means the market growth rate will increase. It will ultimately benefit the consumer because there will be more competition between suppliers. So the rate will be decreased in near future. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for presenting the paper on the agro processing. This also. So thank you very much. So let I invite Yogeshwari Sahu and AK Sarwagi for their paper cost return analysis of okra production of Ballard district of Chhattisgarh.
Hello.
Yes.
I'm audible, sir.
Yes, yes. Yogeshwari?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please continue. Yes, please.
So my screen is coming out.
Your screen is visible, but there is no PPT. It's just showing the Zoom login. Login begin.
Speak please loudly.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay, start. PPT is visible.
Good morning to all respected sir and ma'am. Today I will be Sri Sahu and yes sir.
Yeah, please continue.
Today, Ayogeshwari Sahu, I'm a PhD scholar, College of IGTV, Raipur, Chhattisgarh. And today, I'm presenting, and my presentation topic is cost return analysis of okra production in Ballard district of Chhattisgarh. Now, an introduction part, some important key points are included in this introduction part. That is, India is the second largest vegetable producing country in the world. Among the vegetable crop, the okra crop is the most important crop. And it is a good source of protein, minerals, and carbohydrates and other nutrients. And now, during the 2012 and 2013, India is stand first in the okra production in the world and contributing 17.90% share of the total world production. And during the 2015-16, the estimated area of okra crop in Chhattisgarh is 30134 hectare and production 340198 metric tons in Chhattisgarh state. And now my research objective is to work out the cost and returns of okra production under different size of farm in the study area. And now coming the research methodology part. The research methodology part is the I have converted the flow chart, and the sample design is shows in the flow chart. In Chhattisgarh state, I have selected the Ballard district, and in that district, I have selected namely five blocks, namely Ballard, Gurur, Gundardhar, Dandi, and Dandi Lohara. And in that blocks, I have selected the only one blocks, Ballard, because Ballard block is the highest cultivated of okra crop. And in that blocks, I have selected the five villages named Khursipar, Arod, Niwarikala, Jagnathpur, and Tekapar. And in that villages, I have selected 60 farmers, 20 small size, 20 medium, and 20 large size farmers. And my research is period of study is 2016-17. Now in that slides, I have explained the following some cost concept and profitability aspects, and it is also calculated that. And next, I have come in the result and discussion. And next 3 to 4 slides already prepared the PPT for the socioeconomic status of the sample farmers, but time is not allowed. So I will not explain, but in the most important slides we are presenting here. Now, and the next slide is the average operational fixed cost of okra under different size groups. In this table, the labor cost is also high in the small size groups as compared to the medium and large. And the material and indirect cost and also the total cost is also high the large group farmers as compared to the medium and large. And in the tables, the operational cost, the cost was 60.61% be cost, and in the operational material cost accounts 8.6%. And now coming the cost of okra concept. Under this table, the total cost of okra was found to be rupees 119,186.00, and the percentage of cost A22 cost C3 was 56.20. And now next production of okra crop under different size group farmers. In this table, the first to third picking increasing trend was observed for all the three size groups. It was also observed that about 54% during the first and third picking under different sites, while the production of okra decreases during fourth and sixth picking in all the size groups. And it was average 46% production. Maximum production of okra was recorded in all the size groups during the first picking. And overall, the average productivity of okra was observed 110.12 quintal per hectare. And now, next slide, picking wise gross income of okra production. In this table, the picking wise gross income is dependent on selling price of the okra and different picking. The quantity and selling price of okra was observed vary in different picking under all the size groups. It was observed that lowest and highest during picking period was observed 1300 and 2000 rupees per quintal respectively. It means due to the variation in price and quantity of okra production during different picking under different size groups, so the gross income was also vary. And the my next slide is net income from okra production. Under these slides, the under these tables, the total cost of cultivation per hectare was highest in the large size groups, followed by the medium and small. The cost of production per quintal of okra crop was also found same trend as total cost. And the on an average, the cost of production of okra was rupees 1081.42 per quintal. And the net income was more under large size followed by the small and medium groups. And the trend of the trend of family labor income and farm business income was same as the trend of net farm income. It means family business income was more than the net farm income and family labor income in all the size groups, which receiving about rupees 1,217,730.45 per hectare when actual total expenses incurred in the okra production is also considered. And now the under the BC ratio, result of the BC ratio shows that the okra crop of farmer invested the rupees 1, then he rupees 1.58. And now explain the conclusion. All the conclusion of research purpose shows that the okra crops is profitable in the study area. And some suggestions like package and practices and other related to the okra cultivation is also provided in the study area. So it will be helpful to the enhance the productivity of the farmers. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Yogeshwari. Your paper is actually showing about the cost return analysis of the okra crop and you have shown that there is no significant difference between the small, medium and large farmers when we talk about the returns to this particular crop. So it's a paper which is showing that there is no significant difference. Now I invite Supriya. Supriya was earlier could not actually present the paper due to some technical snags. Supriya, are you ready?
Good morning, sir.
Supriya, are you ready?
Good morning, sir.
You are ready, you present the paper.
So you are getting my voice?
Yes,
my voice is audible. Okay, sir, my student Harendra Singh will present the paper. Actually, we were facing technical issues earlier, but so he is going to present the paper. He is also
Harendra, are you there? Mr. Harendra. Ms. Supriya?
Yes.
Supriya?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Harendra's screen is visible, sir.
The screen is visible.
Yes, sir. It is visible.
Online?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Now screen is on, sir.
Yeah.
Presentation is there. Yeah, it is visible. Yes, sir.
You're presenting from mobile?
Yes, sir. Actually, we're presenting from mobile.
Go to the full screen, na?
This square full screen?
Yes.
Yeah.
Slide.
We have started slide. Yes.
Right. Go on. Please go on. Yes, Harinder, your voice is not audible. Supriya?
Yes, sir.
Harinder's
voice of Harinder is not audible.
Now he's audible.
We are not getting any voice, please.
Hello?
We are not getting.
Are you hearing my voice?
Yes.
Okay.
Unmute. Let Harendra unmute himself.
My
voice is not audible, Harendra.
Maybe he has muted himself.
I'm checking, sir.
Give your system to him.
Now he's audible, sir.
No.
Harendra's voice is not audible. Supriya, your voice is audible, but not.
Here we go.
Now he will be audible, sir. I have unmuted his mic.
Yes, please start.
Mic is off. Harendra, your mic is off. You own your mic.
Harendra, we are not getting your voice.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, please start.
Mic is not on.
Okay.
I think.
It's on. Now screen is visible, sir?
Screen is visible, but his voice is, we are not getting his voice.
I think his mic is on mute, you know.
Mic, because.
Madam, make him sit on.
Yes, sir. Allow me to share the screen.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Allow me to share the screen.
Priya, you carry on, please.
Yes, sir. Sir, allow me to share the screen. Because it is showing that you cannot start screen share while the other participant is sharing.
Start the slideshow on the other, but speak on the other system. You can try that.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
And mute one system. Mute the other system. We are getting echo.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. To present, the topic is role of finance in resource use efficiency and constraints in banana cultivation in Bahraich district of Uttar Pradesh. Actually, we belong to Acharya Narendra Dev University in UP. So, next slide. Are you getting my voice?
Yes, please continue,
please.
Okay. First of all, we talk about finance in agriculture is logistics, because finance is an important thing. Inputs can chase and used by farmers has insufficient machine is enabled, including the constraints both to agriculture credit and its repayment, and to suggest suitable measures to overcome them. Okay. So for metrology, we adopt purposive come random sampling techniques to select the farmers, and for study all selected sample farmers, we have grouped them three categories. As we know, marginal, below 1 hectare, small, 1 to 2 hectares, and medium, 2 to 4 hectares. And 2 to 4 hectares and above. Functional analysis, we analyze the data through COP-WS production function and used for measuring the resource use efficiency and the mathematical form we know of COP-WS function. To calculate marginal value productivity, we have used the formula VJ-Y bar equal X. Mean constant analysis was done through Garrett ranking technique to rank the constraints faced by respondents in adoption of the finance. We have calculated related percent positions and we give ranks to the constraints. For results and discussions, we have divided input parts. Part A, source use efficiency in banana production at borrowers and non-borrowers sample farms. We got high value part coefficient of critical differential of the fitted function, which indicates that sufficient and large proportion of total variation in the dependent variable is explained by included inputs in the function. In borrower case, whereas the 5 variables, namely suckers, feed, manure and fertilizer, irrigation charge, human labor and plant protection jointly explained 90.61, 93.03, 95.05% variation, whereas in non-verbal case, 87.17, 91.86, and 96.11 of the dependent variable on marginal, small, and medium farm size group perspective. In borrower case, returns to scale on marginal, small, medium farms was 0.86, 0.90, and 0.93. And in bond borrower case, 0.84. Respective farms, we have different like marginal, small, medium. There are different inputs X1, X2, X3. And returns to scale were in case of small, 0.90, and in case of medium, 0.93. R square values we got 0.90 in case of medium marginal, and in case of small farmers, 0.93. And medium farmers, we have 0.95. Similarly, we have for non-borrower farmers, returns to scale were 0.8449 in case of marginal, 0.88 small, and base was 9. R square values were 0.87, 0.91, and 0.96 respectively. Significance was at 1% probability level, which was shown through 2 stars, and through 1 star, we show significance at 5% probability level. X1, X2, X3, X4, and X5, these are the variables for stands for suckers, manures, fertilizer, irrigation charge, human labor, and plant protection. In case of marginal value productivity, table indicates in case of borrower, all categories of farms, the ratio of MVP to factor cost was found more than unity, which indicates further scope to increase investment on these factors to realize return more than the cost. Similarly, in case of farm categories, we have different variables. We have part C, in which we show the constraints which were being faced in getting a loan or finance and to suggestions to overcome them. It was shown through this table 3, which reveals that constraints about the agriculture finance for the borrower. The ranking was done using Garrett's ranking technique for different type of constraints, and it was observed from the borrower that the Garrett score of 38.52 and ranked first was found to major problem in was hectic documentation being practiced by banker office. 30.40 of the borrower were faced the problem, which was mainly delay in disbursement of loan, and that was ranked for second. It was also observed that among repayment period, which was not sufficient, identified as a major constraint, and their Garrett score was 37.40, having ranked third. Similarly, we have shown different constraints being faced by farmers with percent position and Garrett's value and their ranks. We have given recommendation and suggestions in the last. So the main recommendation for linking credit with marketing is an important way to improve the performance in term of short-term recovery loans. Installing a term loan should be a small amount that we very important awareness of its benefits, regular motivation of this among respondents. In this can be given a part with an authenticated land or simply
Priya, we are missing your voice.
It over. So Priya, is it over? Over. Okay, so Priya, it's a good paper. You have to see to it. When we talk about the efficiency and non-borrowers, significant difference between the efficiency. Secondly, the marginal value product of the borrowers and non-borrowers have not been checked whether they are significantly different or not. So please, I think this paper is a good paper. And
actually, sir, this work is being focused and we will do that.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
And thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, Supriya, thank you very much.
Okay, okay, thank you, sir. I'm unmuting my mic.
Now, let me invite the next paper. It's a joint paper. That's written by Narinder Singh and V.M. Thomar about the socio-economic and value chain analysis of goat farming in South Gujarat region. Who would be present?
I will be present, sir. Narendra Singh is presenting, sir.
Okay, sir. Okay. Narendra Singh, continue, please.
Okay, sir. So other participant will mute the sharing. So I will share the screen. Screen share nahi ho rahi sir.
Share screen click. Please click on the share screen.
Isme there is a notification other participant sharing the screen.
So he has not unshared it.
Dr. Mahajan, please stop sharing your screen, sir.
I think share.
Stop share. Click okay. On stop share. Vandana Pawar, please mute yourself.
So somebody is sharing screen.
Dr. Mahajan?
Yes.
Sir, please click on the stop sharing. Stop share.
I think this is sharing screen.
Okay, right now. Okay. Mr. Narendra, please start.
Yes, sir.
Narendra.
Yes. Yes. Open the PPT, please.
Yes, sir.
Yes, it's okay. Please continue.
Good morning to all, sir.
Yes, good morning.
My topic is socio-economic and value chain analysis of goat farming in South Gujarat region. I am from Navsari Agriculture University, Navsari. Now, the importance of the goat farming is among the small ruminants, goat is perhaps the most useful animal providing milk as well as meat. It is also superior in converting the feed to meat and other products in a short period than most of the other livestock. Goat contributes milk, meat, fiber, skins and manures to the subsistence of the smallholders and landless rural poor. Goat meat accounts for almost 37% of total meat production in the country. Goat requires relatively much lower investment and facilities in terms of the housing, feed, labor, health, care. There is a quick pay of the dues because of the fast multiplication and early maturity. Further, the risk involved in the goat farming is much lower compared to the other livestock and crop production. In Gujarat state, population of milch goat has shown increasing trend as it was 68,100 in 1983-84 and in year 2017-18 it found 31,33,600, which shows 45% increase in population. Then data and methodology, three districts from the South Gujarat region was purposely selected for the study. These districts possess 43% of the total goat population. The study was undertaken in the in randomly selected 180 farmers from the 18 villages of the three districts. And there are two breeds, Surti and local breeds. This is the sampling plan of the study and result and discussion. The results of the study were divided into the three groups. Distribution of the goat per household, second is profitability analysis of the goat farming, third is marketing of goat. Now we come to the distribution of the goat. The number of goats with buck and kid belongs to the Surti and local breed per household owned by the different herd size groups has been shown in table 1. The number of the goat was higher in the local breeds, that is 2843, than the Surti breed, which is 793. These are the details of the distribution of the goat per households. Then we come to the economics of the goat farming. The total expenditure of the goat farming was divided into various components like value of the existing stock, cost of the feed, cost of the labor, value of the set, miscellaneous cost and veterinary expenses, and interest on the working capital. The annual total expenditure per goat per year was worked out to ₹5,521.76 for all small herd size groups and ₹4,932.62 for medium size herd group and ₹4,580.67 for the large size herd group. The details are given in the table 2. This is the details of the comparative economics of the goat breeders. Goat breeds. This is per goat in rupees. The total cost is for overall is 4,201.55. And the net return for overall is 2,034.19 rupees. Then we come to the value chain analysis, marketing channel. The four main marketing channel for the transaction of the male goat in the study area were farmer to farmer, farmer to butcher, farmer to local trader, then butcher, farmer to distance trader, then farmer. Channel wise distribution shows 80% of the male goat sold through the channel, second that is farmer to butcher, and 5% respondent use channel third, that is farmer to local trader to butcher, and 10% farmers use the channel first, that is farmer to farmer. Only 2 to 3% respondent use the channel fourth, means farmer, distance trader and farmer. These are the some photographs for the goat market Surat. This is the Surti breed. This is the management practice of the goat. Management practice of the goat. Then we come to the marketing. Marketing cost, margin and price is paid in marketing of goat. This is in rupees per goat. So net price received by the producer is 95.89 in channel first, 94.45 in channel second, in channel third 80.04, and in channel fourth 81.44. So if we compare the marketing efficiency of all the four channels, 23.34 in channel first, 17.02 in channel second, 15.37 in channel third, and 20.36 in channel fourth. So we can say the channel first is more efficient than other channels. Then we come to the sustainable farmers income through the goat farming. The relative contribution of the various income sources are shown in table 4. The contribution of agriculture, that is agriculture and livestock, amounted to 68.70%. The total livestock contribution is 23% of the total income, out of which goat contributes 15.27%. This means goat contribute good. The finding provides that for efficient utilization of resources, goat farming is profitable entity, and it might be double the farmer's income. So this is the detailed presentation about the summary of the goat keeper's income analysis. So I already discussed this table. Then conclusion and suggestions. It can be concluded that goat farming with improved breed of prevalent species and larger herd size is highly remunerative enterprise. It was observed that Sooty goat keepers followed better feeding management practices as compared to the local goat keepers. This is in turn enhanced their profit by way of higher productivity of the Sooty goat. On the basis of the study, it can be suggested that local goat keepers should keep improved breed of the goat with good management practices so that the economic position of the goat keepers can be improved to a considerable extent. Goat farming should be introduced at small and marginal farms for raising the farmer's income due to its low cost and high income. Thank you, sir.
So thank you very much, Narinder Singh ji. You have concluded that for the sustainable income of the farmers, goat farming can be a good case, you know. At the same time, if the farmers want to do a mixed farming, then goat farming can be a better opportunity, and it can double the farmer's income. Okay, thank you very much for presenting a good paper. Thank you. Let I invite the next paper presenter, Babita Kathyat, Priyanka Lal, and A.K. Deekshit.
Hello, good morning, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Okay, sir, I'll start sharing the screen. You cannot start screen when others participant is there. I would request the previous participant to
Dr. Narendra, please click on stop sharing. Yeah. Is it Babita or Priyanka speaking?
Sir, this is Babita. I'll be presenting the paper.
Right. Thank you. Please continue.
Okay. Whether it is visible, my slide?
Yes, yes. Open the PPT.
It's visible. Okay. Good morning, everyone. My name is Babita Kathyat. I'm PhD in NDRI National Dairy Research Institute.
So open the PPT.
Your desktop is only visible.
Oh, not the being, is, being shared.
Yes. I have already.
Perhaps you have minimized it. Open once again. Maximize it.
Okay.
Yes. Go to full screen slideshow.
So now it's visible?
Yes, it's okay. Please continue.
Okay, good morning. I'll be presenting this paper on has the average consumption pattern changed in an overview of livestock products? So basically, we know that consumption preference for any kind of product, especially for livestock products, is influenced by several factors like economic, social, cultural, and market factors. India being largely vegetarian population, we know that livestock preference for livestock products is less like meat, but there is huge preference for dairy products. And income is one of the most important economic factor which derives the changes in consumption behavior. And although we have achieved self-sufficiency in food grain production, but still we are home to one of the largest malnourished population in the world. About 15% of our population is undernourished, and also we have one of the largest population which is more prone to hunger and starvation. So in this scenario, to overcome these challenges of nutritional undernourishment, we livestock products can be very important, very efficient, because livestock products are considered to be more nutritionally superior. They are known to have certain nutrients which are not offered by plant-based food items. And also studies have shown that livestock owning households, they have greater food security because as a result of consumption of greater food livestock products. So now we know that livestock products have greater contribution towards better health outcomes. So the objective of this study is basically, I have tried to address three broad issues, like if there is any change in the consumption behavior of Indian households over time, and if there is any change, then which food groups are more preferred, and whether livestock products are really rising in importance with respect to consumption in Indian households. So narrowing down these broad issues, we are coming to two objectives that I have set up for this studies. First objective is to study the change in consumption expenditure pattern between 1970 to 2011-12, and second is to estimate the income elasticities of different food items. Coming to the data and methodology, for this data, I have entirely used secondary sources. Like I have utilized 7 to 8 rounds of consumption expenditure, household consumption expenditure surveys conducted by NSS. And the latest I have used 2011-12 because when I was writing this paper, data for 2015-16 was not released. So the latest is 2011-12. And to study the changes in consumption expenditure pattern, I have basically done tabular analysis and calculated percentages and shares. And to study the relationship between income and food consumption, I have estimated income elasticities, and that is for the latest data of 2011-12. So to estimate the income elasticities, I have used double log functional form. So you can see here. Now, coming to the results for the first point, that is change in consumption behavior over time. You can see the first graph here. I'm showing the change in rural consumption expenditure pattern. And this blue line, it shows the consumption pattern for 1970-71, and the yellow one shows 2011-12. So you can see that from 1970s, clearly there has been a shift. The share of cereals, the consumption expenditure towards cereals has drastically declined. Earlier, it used to be more than 50% of the share. Now it has come down to around 20%. And similarly, the importance of livestock products in household consumption has raised because the share for expenditure towards livestock products has increased to 24% from 15%. And at the same time, we see that there is a rise in consumption for other food items. This include those processed food items, beverages mainly. So we see that in the recent time, there has been a higher expenditure towards other food items as well as livestock, but the expenditure towards the share of expenditure towards cereals and like pulses and vegetables has declined. And in urban areas, similar trend has been observed. The share of expenditure earlier used to be more than 35% for cereals alone, but now it has come down to around 15% in urban areas. And also livestock products occupies the highest share in consumption expenditure, that is around 25% of the expenditure goes towards the livestock products, and the share of other food items also increased. Now the per capita consumption expenditure for meat group and dairy products. So for meat groups, it includes egg, fish, meat. Meat includes further mutton, beef, chicken, pork, all other kinds of meats available. So again, you see in the pie chart, I have clearly shown the monthly per capita consumption expenditure of different meat items. Here in rural areas, the highest expenditure is towards fish and prawn. And the share of expenditure is highest for fish and prawn, followed by chicken, and then mutton, and then eggs. And similarly, in urban household, the highest share is for chicken, followed by fish and prawn, and then mutton, and last egg, and all other groups are having minuscule share. So we can, from this, we know that average monthly per capita expenditure on items under meat group was ₹68.46 in rural areas, and in urban areas, the average monthly expenditure per capita expenditure was higher, ₹95.99. At national level, the average monthly per capita expenditure on the items of this meat group was ₹164.45. Similarly, I have further classified the dairy group into the dairy group includes milk, liquid milk, baby food, milk powder, curd, ghee, butter, ice cream. This is as per the classification done for NSS survey. So here again, we see the liquid milk, it constitutes the highest share both in urban areas as well as rural areas. A rural household spends about ₹106 per month per person in liquid milk consumption. And at the same time, an urban household spent ₹158. Highest share of liquid milk is followed by the ghee, and then demand of curd. So highest demand is for liquid milk, followed by ghee and curd in dairy products group. So now coming to the estimation of income elasticities for different food items. In rural, I have through in this table, I have depicted both for rural as well as urban areas. You can see that the income elasticity for fruits, milk and milk products, beverages, processed food items, as well as served processed food items is positive in both rural as well as urban areas. That means with rise in income, consumers are spending more towards these items, while the income elasticity is negative for cereal, pulses, vegetable oil, and vegetable edible oil and spices, because with rise in income, the expenditure towards these income and towards these products decreases. So there is definitely the importance of the milk and milk products is increasing, but the other concern is also there that consumers are spending towards non-nutritional food items like processed food items. So this is the pattern observed, and income elasticity of milk and milk products was around 0.73 in rural areas and 0.26 in urban areas. That means with 1% rise in income, an expenditure made towards milk and milk product increases by 0.7% in rural areas, and it increases by 0.3% in urban areas. So definitely the importance of livestock products is rising, as you can see, with rise in income. Coming to the conclusion, consumption pattern of an average Indian household has been shifting more towards the high value food items like livestock products and fruits. The share of expenditure of cereal has definitely declined. At the same time, the share of livestock products in per capita household expenditure is rising. And other food groups like food, fruits, beverages, dairy products are also showing positive income elasticities. So we can see that with increase in demand of the livestock products, we need to look towards the supply side. We have to enhance our supply to meet these increasing demand, and also being nutritionally superior, if incorporated these livestock products into various various programs which are carried out by government, like targeted public distribution system, ICDS and mid-day meal, we have a option to enhance the to overcome the nutritional challenges faced by the country. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Pavita. Your paper is regarding the increase in income as well as what has been the changes in the consumption pattern. I see, it's a good paper. If you see the Angel's curve, Angel's curve is also showing the same type of thing.
Yes, sir.
About the same. Because the with the passage of time, the cereal consumption actually goes down. As when we talk about the other nutritional products, particularly when we take into consideration that it be the milk and milk products and protein products, we find that there is an increase in the consumption of the same. I think you should that why and value of the particular people would increase by the same. I think that would be the one of the your objectives when you be finishing the whole particular thesis. So it's a good paper. Thank you very much, participant. It's a joint paper by Prasanna Kolar and Deepak Rathi. Analysis of land use pattern and determinants of fallow land across various agroclimatic zones for Madhya Pradesh. Prasanna Kolar and Deepak Rathi.
Yes, sir. Am I audible, Prasanna? Sir?
Yes, audible.
Is it Deepak?
It is Prasanna Kolar.
Okay. Please continue.
Is slide visible?
Babita, please stop sharing your screen. Babita, please stop sharing your screen. Babita, Priyanka, anyone there? Babita?
Hello?
Please stop sharing your screen. Stop share.
Okay.
Yeah, Prasanna, please continue.
Sir, is slide visible?
Yes. Open the, it's your face being visible?
No, sir.
You have a PPT?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, start sharing. Click on share screen. Click on share screen.
Yes.
Yeah, it's okay. Full screen, slideshow. Yes, it's okay. Please continue.
Very good morning to everyone. I am Prasanna Kolar. Today I am here to present on analysis of land use pattern and determinants of fallow land across various agroclimatic zones of Madhya Pradesh. Relevance of the study. The information on the land use pattern is necessary to develop future strategies on land use planning and land use policies. Land use studies are important for the resource base of a region under evaluation of rational use, conservation, and management of land resources. A close study of present land use pattern and trend during the recent year will help to suggest the scope for planned shifts in the pattern and also in the development of agriculture economy. So coming to the objectives of the study. First objective is to analyze the growth of different parameters of land use pattern across various agroclimatic zones of Madhya Pradesh. And second objective is to determine the factors responsible for fallow land across various agroclimatic zones of Madhya Pradesh. So methodology. All the 11 agroclimatic zones of Madhya Pradesh were selected for the study. And time series data for the period, and these are the source of the data. Specific variables and parameters such as forest, uncultivated land, cultivable wasteland, current fallow land, net sown area, gross cropped area, rainfall, gross irrigated area, and cropping intensity. These are the parameters which were considered for the study. And for empirical analysis, absolute change, relative change, coefficient of variation, trend, compound growth rate, t-test, and multiple regression analysis were used. Coming to the results. From the left side, you can see figure 1 shows share of different parameters of land use pattern in geographical area of Madhya Pradesh in the base year. And figure 2 shows in the current year. So base year here is triennium average from 2000 to 2023. And current year is the triennium average from 2011 to 13%. So forest area was 15%. So forest area reduced by 3% and uncultivated land was reduced by 1% and cultivable wasteland was remained same. Current fallow was reduced by 1%. Old fallow almost remained same. And net area sown was reduced by 4%. Whereas gross cropped area was increased by 3%. And area sown more than once was also increased by 6%. Coming to the table, this table shows growth of different parameters across various agroclimatic zones of Madhya Pradesh. Here I have shown the compound growth rates, and here 3-star indicates 1% level of significance and 2-star indicates 5% level of significance. Coming to forest area, in out of 11 agroclimatic zones, Bundelkhand region showed maximum increase in forest area of 0.22% per annum, which was highly significant, whereas Nimad Valley showed highly significant decline in the forest area of 0.04% per annum. Whereas in uncultivated land, Malwa Plateau showed a highly decline in the uncultivated area compared to other zones, and in state as well, there was decline, highly significant decline in the uncultivated land. Coming to cultivable wasteland, Bundelkhand region showed highly decline in the area compared. Coming to current fallow land, Garh region has showed highly significant decline compared to other zones. Whereas in the state also, you can see the same results. In net zone area, the Garh region showed a highly significant increase in the area of 0.91% per annum. And in the state also, the area under net zone area increased. And coming to gross crop area, Malwa Plateau was showed highly significant increase in the area of 3.04% per annum. And in the Madhya Pradesh also, the area has increased. Coming to cropping intensity, Malwa Plateau has showed highly significant increase. And in the state also, we can see the same results. This table shows regression coefficient of different parameters which determine the fallow land across various agroclimatic zones of Madhya Pradesh. Here dependent variable was fallow land, and we have considered three variables, independent variables. One is rainfall, second is gross irrigated area, third is cropping intensity. And in the state you can see R square value is 0.683. That is, these three variables explained the variation of 68.3 in the fallow land. Coming to the rainfall, in Nimad Valley, the rainfall has drastically reduced the area under fallow land. That is -0.004. That means 1% increase in rainfall reduces 0.04% of fallow land. Coming to gross irrigated area, Kaimur Plateau, Vindhya Plateau, Central Narmada Valley, Bundelkhand region, Satpura Plateau. In all these zones, increase in gross irrigated area has reduced the area under the fallow land. Coming to cropping intensity, in Central Narmada Valley, Malwa Plateau, Nimad Valley, in all these three zones, increase in cropping intensity has drastically reduced the area under fallow lands. And in the state, we haven't seen any significant results, but out of these zones, we have seen significant results. And we can say that all three variables have resulted in negative impact on the fallow land, reducing fallow land. Coming to limitations, since it is based on secondary data, the validity is therefore based on this data. Coming to the conclusion, we can say that highly significant increase in area was observed in net area zone more than once, gross cropped area, cropping intensity, and net irrigated area. And highly significant decrease was observed in area under uncultivated land, cultivable wasteland, and current fallow land of most of the agroclimatic zones as well as the state. So based on the results obtained from the study, we can suggest following measures to reduce the area under fallow land. First is to increase in gross irrigated area and gross cropped area, which can reduce the area under fallow land. And proper watershed management and in situ conservation, which can help in utilizing rainwater effectively, thereby reducing the fallow land. And rationalization of cropping pattern according to the availability of irrigation water to cover more area under the crops. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Prasanna. It's a very good presentation, and our chairperson is facing some type of connection problem there, so I'll be doing the job here. And basically, you have focused on the land use pattern, and you have shown that the gross cropped area and the net zone area has increased, while the area sown more than once and cropping intensity has also increased. The good thing there in Madhya Pradesh, fallow land has decreased, but the point of concern here is that the forest area has decreased. So yes. this is about 3% you have shown. And when converted to the absolute figure, this is a very big decrease, I think. So thank you very much. Thank you. And the next presentation is next presentation is by Sarita Sharma, R.M. Sahu, A.K. Saravagi, and Brahma Gurjar. And the topic is Economics of Aromatic and Non-Aromatic Rice Production in Bilaspur District of Chhattisgarh. Sarita, are you there?
Hello.
Sarita.
Hello, sir.
Yes, yes. Sarita, please.
Yes.
Kulvinder.
Yeah,
oh, yeah.
Okay, sir.
Kulvinder, stop sharing screen. Yes, Sarita, please continue.
So, how can I share my screen?
Click on share screen.
One second.
Share screen. Are you on a computer system, laptop or mobile?
So, laptop.
Okay, it's on the lower side of the screen, on the bar in the center, share screen. Arrow okay, mark is there.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
click on it, open the PPT. Yes.
Good afternoon. Good morning to all, sir.
Full screen, full screen. F5.
Okay, sir. Million people obtain 60-70% of their calories from rice and its product. In Asia, more than 80% of the people live on rice, and their primary food security is entirely dependent on the volume of rice produced in the part of the world. The scented rice or aromatic rice is a popular crop in the Asia, gained wide acceptance in Europe and the United States. The aroma in aromatic and the higher bracket rice varieties than methodology. Then objective. Comparative cost and return analysis of aromatic and non-aromatic rice production in Bilaspur district of Chhattisgarh. Methodology. Bilaspur district of Chhattisgarh state selected because of increasing area under rice, aromatic rice. Then sample. The collection of primary data through simple random sampling methods from 60 farmers of 5 villages, in which 30 were aromatic and 30 non-aromatic rice growers. Data collection. The required primary data was collected from selected farmers with the help of personal interview schedule, personal interview schedule. The required secondary data related to background of study area and collected from different publication sites. Then result. Cost of cultivation of aromatic and non-aromatic rice under the different size of sample respondent, rupees per hectare. Here, total labor cost. In case of aromatic rice, average total labor cost is 16,277.91. That is higher as compared to non-aromatic rice form, because aromatic rice required more intensive care in the field of intercultural operation and pest management. Then the material cost. Average total material cost of aromatic rice is 7,701.48, is higher as compared to non-aromatic rice. Here 7,393.59 rupees per hectare. Because the seed rate, fertilizer consumption and plant protection methodology is higher in aromatic rice production. Then total operational cost. The average operational cost of aromatic rice is higher as compared to the non-aromatic rice. Here aromatic rice average operational cost is 24,747.31 rupees, and non-aromatic rice average total operational cost is 23,511.66 rupees per hectare. Then total fixed cost. The total fixed cost of aromatic rice is higher as compared to non-aromatic rice because of high value of labor cost than operational cost. The total cost in case of aromatic rupees per hectare, and it is higher, and as compared to non-aromatic rice, average total cost of cultivation is 14,214.60 rupees per hectare. Because the labor and material and operational and fixed cost is higher in case of aromatic rice growing farmers. Then cost concepts. Here, in case of aromatic rice, average cost C3 is higher as compared to non-aromatic rice farm. Then cost and return of aromatic and non-aromatic rice crop for different size of sample respondent in rupee pair. Yield of aromatic rice, average of aromatic rice quintal per hectare is 6.1 and that is lower compared to non-aromatic rice yield. The average gross income of aromatic rice is higher as compared to non-aromatic rice growers. Cost production. In case of aromatic rice, average cost of production is higher than the non-aromatic rice. Net income. Then profitability of aromatic and non-aromatic rice crop under different size groups is net income. The average net income of net income of aromatic rice farm is higher as compared to non-aromatic rice grower. The average benefit cost ratio of aromatic rice in cost C3. Benefit cost ratio of aromatic rice is higher than the non-aromatic rice. It means aromatic rice grower earn more profit as compared to non-aromatic rice grower. I conclude that benefit cost ratio is quite good in case of aromatic rice so it can be preferred by farmers for its production. Then conclusion. The cost of cultivation incurred in aromatic and non-aromatic rice production be reduced by curtailing the labor cost in a small size farm by adopting improved production technology and intensive cultivation. Then extension agencies should be strengthening to popularize the improved production technologies and farming problems in the village, thus production level may be improved. The improved variety seeds, though govern higher unit price, but also provide high productivity and returns. They are therefore to be used as per the capacity of the growers. Then thank you.
Thank you, Sarita. Thank you for your presentation. You have shown that almost all the cost parameters are higher for the aromatic rice than for the non-aromatic rice. But the yield is quite less for the aromatic rice. However, the higher price per quintal compensates it very well. So in the end, we get a higher net income, which is significantly higher for the aromatic rice than the non-aromatic rice. So the cost benefit ratio also supports this view. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
So the next presentation is by Gaurav Sharma. Gaurav, are you there?
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Yeah, the topic of presentation is marketing of vegetables in Tapi district of Gujarat, a changing marketing scenario. Please.
Can I share the screen, sir?
Yeah, please continue. Yes. Sarita, stop sharing the screen, please. Yeah, it's you now. Over to you. Clear screen. On the lower side, yes, it's okay. Yeah, please continue.
So PPT is visible?
Yes, it's okay, please.
I'm Dr. Gaurav Sharma from Navsari Agriculture University. Topic is marketing of vegetables in Tapi district with the coronavirus pandemic. We are seeing a changing scenario of Indian migrant workers. So many workers are coming back to the rural areas. And in the near future, we have to explore the options to check the movement of these migrant workers in rural workforce and search for the option to employ these youths in the rural or agriculture sector. Even in the fact today, what is happening in China, the countries are not having or taking anything from them or stopping their products. In the near future or in the coming time, definitely India has to come forward and we have to provide foods to so many persons. So a new opportunity is also building up. Agriculture is already facing issues of disinvestment. Thus, we have to explore the options of secondary agriculture. If we talk in terms of secondary agriculture, it includes manufacturing and so many type of things. But the most appropriate one will be to include these workers in agribusiness. And in the near future, definitely, we are going to have certain chains which can export these vegetables or food grains to the countries. And the present study is a sustained endeavor in this direction. Now, the background, India's land of agriculture, more than 50% of the population is relies on agriculture. Still, the condition of farmers are not so good. The main benefits of all these things are enjoyed by the middlemen. Although the processing as well as so many agriculture-based industries are increasing or getting good growth, but as a farmer, they are not getting a good livelihood. The boards in India are primarily involved in production. They are mainly involved in the production of raw materials. Where the major benefits occurred from consumption is enjoyed by the middlemen. Thus, there is an immediate need to tracking the chains of agribusiness opportunities where boards can be beneficially involved. In this background, we have framed this paper that too in Gujarat, the southern or Deccan region of Gujarat state offers enormous opportunities to place vegetable and contributes 90% of the total vegetable area in the state. The region has several inherited and unique advantages. Thus, this area, that is Tapi district of this area, is selected for the present studies. Now, objective to assess the choices of various marketing channels followed by the vegetable growers. Methodology, the study is conducted in Tapi district with 80 vegetable growers. We have used multiple cluster sampling. At first stage, 3 principal vegetable markets were selected. At second stage, 2 retail markets were selected. At third stage, 8 cluster of villages feeding the primary and secondary market were selected. And lastly, 10 farmers each. That is, the total sample consists of 80 vegetable growers. Only major vegetables were selected for the study, that is okra, brinjal, cluster bean, zwar, tomato, chili, cauliflower, sangan. We also have included certain market functionaries, that is 15 wholesalers and 10 retailers. Now, result and discussion. The major marketing channels of vegetables in Tapi district. Consuming centers located outside the study area. There are certain vegetables, specifically okra, which is off-seasonally produced in this area, which is sent outside. That is, demand of this product, demand of okra, that is off-season okra, is very much high outside the study area. So, we have divided the chains in 2 categories, that is consuming center located outside the study area and consuming center or indigenous consuming regions, that is within the state demand is consumed. In outside the study area, there are 2 channels. First, when growers are selling to the wholesaler, come commission agent, then buyers, then growers are selling to the procurement centers, rather certain processing persons or export persons are there who have opened the procurement centers and they are purchasing on behalf of the exporters. The buyers at the end of the marketing channel 1 and 2 are primary commission agents procuring okra on behalf of the demand, both national and international, located outside the district. The study of marketing channel till the end consumer, that is, if in case of the international, we have to go to the international buyers, and that is not possible for our study. Thus, the study is constructed to primary marketing dealing with marketing within the study area. The 2 marketing channels in the indigenous consuming regions are, first, growers, wholesaler, retailers, consumer, and channel four, growers, retailer, consumer. So these last two marketing channels are traditional based, and these two marketing channels are emerging one. That is, in the near future, they will also get much more things. So this is the marketing channel of Aurora. Over four marketing channels are shown. And over here we can see that the highest money is received by second and fourth marketing channels. Pictorial depiction of the net price received by different marketing. Depiction of farmers' net price received by different marketing channels of okra. Over here, the channel within outside the district, we found out for brinjal, this is for guar, this is for tomato, this is for cowpea, and this is summarized of all the channels which are consumed within the study area. And over here we can see, find it out that the benefit got by the farmers are higher in the second market channel. But this is definitely, when farmers, the number of middlemen's are number is less, then farmers are going to get more major benefits. Comparative marketing assessment in case of the indigenous or within consuming state, we can find it out that channel 2 is having highest efficiency. So I am going to conclude it out that in the near future we have to find out certain options like processing, somehow link these farmers in the processing or agro processing, so that farmers can also get the benefit. That is all from my side. Thank you.
Hello. Yes, Gaurav, thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
It has shown that the marketing channel outside the region are more efficient than the local ones. So, next presentation is by Hardeesh Kaur and Sukhdev Singh. Are you there, please? Hardeesh or Sukhdev? Hardeesh or Sukhdev? I think they haven't joined. Then the next one is by Priyanka Sharma, T.S. Rayard, and Lavlish Garg. Anyone from them? Priyanka Sharma.
Hello.
Please unmute.
Hello.
Yourself. Yeah, Priyanka.
Sir, good afternoon.
Priyanka Sharma, the topic of the presentation is public-private partnership in agricultural extension, a strategy for increasing farmers' income. So who is presenting this paper? Gaurav, please stop sharing your screen.
Hello.
Yes, Priyanka. Please start.
Morning, sir.
Very good morning. Share your screen, Priyanka.
Yes, sir. I'm doing
it. Are you getting some technical issues? Gaurav, please stop sharing screen.
I have already stopped.
No, you are visible on the screen now. And mute yourself, please. Yeah. Kulvinder, stop.
Hello.
Yes, Priyanka, please start.
Morning, sir.
Yes, good morning. Please start. Share your screen. Click on the share
my
screen.
Sir.
Hello. Yeah, Priyanka.
Hello, myself Priyanka Sharma. Today I'm going to present my review paper on the topic is public-private partnership in agriculture extension. That is a strategy for increasing.
Priyanka, do you have any PPT or you are going
yes.
to oral presentation?
Sir, I'm presenting through my laptop.
No, you have a PPT. You have a PowerPoint presentation. Pulvinder, stop sharing the screen. Pulvinder, stop sharing the screen. Pulvinder. You hear me? Pulvinder, stop sharing screen. Pulvinder, Dr. Mahajan. Sir, yes. Now it's the second last presentation in our session. Priyanka is going to present her paper on public-private partnership in agricultural extension, a strategy for increasing farmers' income. Sir, unmute yourself, please.
Yes, myself Priyanka Sharma. I have just completed my PhD from Punjab Agricultural University, Ludhiana, and I'm going to present.
Your PPT is not visible, Priyanka. Priyanka, your PPT is not visible. Yes, Priyanka. Yes, Dr.
Priyanka, your PPT is not visible.
Hello.
I think, yes, yes. Yes, Priyanka. Priyanka, your PPT
Hello?
Is not visible. Your PPT is not visible.
Sir, I'm.
Or you don't have PPT. Have you PPT for your presentation?
Dr. Mahajan, please stop sharing your screen, sir.
Okay, okay.
Stop share. Sir, please click on stop share.
Stop share.
Priyanka, just a minute. Stop share.
Hello.
Yeah, Priyanka, just a minute. Okay. Time just gives a come around. Sir, sir, आगे.
Hello.
Yes. Yes. Yes, Priyanka.
Hello.
Yes, Priyanka, please start.
Yes, Priyanka.
Open the PPT.
Okay, sir. My topic is public-private partnership in agriculture extension, a strategy for increasing farmers' income.
Yes.
And I will, the purpose, as we all know that the purpose of extension is
Yes. Priyanka, you have a PPT. It's not visible on the screen. Double click on the full screen.
Sir, I have...
We're not getting your PPT if you have one. Okay, if you are facing any type of problem, please make an oral presentation.
Priyanka, you should go for the oral presentation. That would be good.
Dr. Sir, please click on stop share.
Stop share.
Yes.
Is the screen visible, sir?
It's okay, Priyanka, you continue, make an oral presentation. I think you are getting some problem in sharing your PPT.
Sir,
unmute yourself. Priyanka, unmute yourself. Yes, Priyanka, please start.
Yes, sir. The purpose of extension is to disseminate advice to the farmers. And in this changing time, as we all know that public extension alone is not sufficient to address the multifaceted problems faced by the farmers. So, as we know that there are various extension systems in India. The first one is public sector extension, which is at center level. It is run by under the Ministry of Agriculture, which includes the Indian Council of Agriculture Research and Directorate of Extension. And at state levels, there are state agriculture departments.
Click on slideshow.
And state. Okay, sir. Okay.
Slideshow on the upper side. Yes, it's okay.
Okay, please, sir. Okay, sir.
Please continue. Kulvinder, stop sharing. Yes, Priyanka, continue.
And the third one is agriculture technology management agencies, which are working at district level. So in public sector extension, we have discussed. Next one is private sector extension, in which both funding and information delivering is through private entities like various farmer associations, agriculture development agents, etc. Then there and then the one which is public-private partnership. Here it is an arrangement by which the public sector and private sector, they both come together to deliver various services which have traditionally been delivered by the government agencies. What is the concept of public-private partnership? It is in this a private entity provides a public service and assumes substantial financial, technical, and operational risks in the projects. It also supplements scarce public resources and.
Right. That's why ek hun jo best presentation das dende ji kinu sochde ho tusi. ਉਹ ਤੇ ਭੇਜ ਦਿਓ ਜੀ ਮੜੇ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਵੀ ਟਿਕ ਕਰਾ ਦਿਓ ਪਲੀਜ਼
and it creates a more competitive environment and helps to improve efficiencies and reduce the costs
okay ji okay
now what is the need for public private partnership
okay ji
the first one is the wide extension okay, worker farmer ratio in India
Okay.
Second one is to reduce the financial burden on the government.
Right, right.
Third is to confirm the role of village level extension workers. Then for commercialization of agriculture.
Number one.
Various elements of elements of public partnership are the first one are the partners or the stakeholders like government, various NGOs, corporate sector, cooperative sector, farmer interest groups.
Okay ji
and other farmer groups second are the inputs can be in form of funds seeds pesticides farm literature latest technology
okay haan ji eh do number te hega ji toda philai yamuna ravi nandran ja organic agri business wala ji ek number
phase 1
employment jaspal singh right sir thank you doctor sir thank you
Dr. Thor, mute your mic. Yes, continue, Priyanka.
Then third one is the process of public-private partnership, which includes four phases. First one is for first phase is project identification and need analysis. Second phase is public-private partnership decision and project appraisal. Third is the final approval and procurement of the process. Fourth phase is implementation and monitoring of the project. Then fourth element is the output. Output is the whatever change we observe in the knowledge, attitude and behavior of people of a particular society where the program has been implemented. Then SWOT analysis of public-private partnership process. There are various strengths of this this strategy. First one is solving the problem of public sector through budget restraint. Second is advanced technology and high management skills. Third is risk transferring and sharing of the funds to private entities. Fourth is facilitation and encouragement for development. Then are the weaknesses. Various weaknesses of the process are low profits to private sector, complexity of organizations, sometimes poor governance of public agencies. Fourth is the authentication and trust issues. Then are the opportunities for the public-private partnership. Opportunities are as there is great need for private sector extension. Various political supports due to partnership with public sector and there are large number of farming families in India therefore there is a great opportunity for public private partnership then there are less number of government extension professionals which also creates opportunities for private extension sector then there are also some threats to the public private partnership which are there is a relatively low level of commitments sometimes and then inadequate legal framework and unclear responsibility of public and private sector then lack of non-profit organizations in our country then lack of related public private partnership professionals then which can be the potential private extension service providers or various which can be the various stakeholders in public private extension process First one, they can be any type of agricultural professionals, any farmer organizations, input dealers, various agribusiness companies, various NGOs working in the country, and even the print and electronic media can also be the potential partners in the public-private partnership. Then various potential areas for public-private partnership in agriculture extension system. First one is for the purpose of technology dissemination, then for the sales of input and processing and marketing of agricultural products, then for the infrastructure development or support in the form of infrastructure, for production, processing, and marketing of the products. And for the different combinations of all of the above areas which we have discussed, then for the purpose of participatory technology development and dissemination of technology. There are some experiences which are already going on in the form of public-private partnership in agriculture extension, like various agriculture.
Priyanka, conclude your paper.
Okay, sir. And so I come to the conclusion that for an effective public-private partnership, there is a need of transparency, flexibility, and scalability. And the public-private partnership or the project should be farmer-centric and farmer-driven, which leads to the empowerment of farming community and also helps in reducing the burden of government and as well as the optimum resource utilization. I think all of the above points, when they will be applicable, then definitely they will help the farmer to help the farmer to have increase in their income and to have a good livelihood. Thank you.
Yeah, Dr. Mahajan. Dr. Mahajan. Dr. Mahajan.
Yes. Tur.
Yes, sir. Please continue. Dr. Tur. Yes, sir.
Please continue. Yes, Priyanka, you have presented a good paper on the PPP in agriculture extension. Now I invite the last presenter, Vandana K. Pawar and SS Kalmakar. They are to present on agriculture growth and crop diversification in India with focus on Gujarat.
Hello.
Yeah, Vandana.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Please start.
Yes, Vandana, sir. Start.
Vandana.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please start. Share your screen. Yes, yes. Open the PPT. Open the PPT. You are visible. Your screen is visible. Minimize the browser and open this PPT. Yes, PPT. Yes. From the start. Now, slideshow. On the upper side, slideshow. Yes, it's okay. Please continue.
Thank you, sir. My name is Pawar Vandana. I'm PhD scholar from Sardar Patel University. My topic is agriculture growth and crop diversification in India with the focus on Gujarat. Introduction. After 1990, agriculture has experienced a significant change with the diversification from traditional food crop to commercial food crop. Though the adoption of Green Revolution in 1960 brought a significant change in crop production and productivity in India, but agriculture traditionally burdened and still found populated. Some associated problem of Indian agriculture still exist are increasing dominance of marginal and small farmer in terms of number and considerable poverty in rural areas, seasonal and underemployment, non-mechanized farm, poor rural infrastructure, monsoon dependency, and extra, always pose a big threat on the development of agriculture economy. From this perspective of improving income generating, stabilization and flow of income over a season and conservation and augmentation of natural resource, crop diversification, that is a shifting from less profitable crop or enterprise to more profitable crop, comes out as a major strategy. It is well proved that the new aid, new and improved technology help India in achieving substantial increase in food production in short period and brought country closer to attain food self-sufficiency by the earlier 80s. However, the slow growth of agriculture recorded in the recent year has been matter of concern among the policymaker, agriculture growth play a crucial role in improving rural employment, reducing rural poverty, and bringing stability in economy. Gujarat is the one of the fastest growing state of India. Gujarat agriculture has shown significant change in the last three decades. It revealed that the agricultural crops has increased over a period of time. The agriculture development of Gujarat has increased after 2000 due to effective agriculture policy relating to irrigation, electrification, research and fertilizer consumption and extra. The main of this paper was to analyze the trend and pattern of agriculture growth and production in India with a special focus on Gujarat state. Methodology. The study is based on secondary level data collected from various publications of Ministry of Agriculture, Government of India, as well as Office of Director of Agriculture, Government of Gujarat, Gandhinagar related websites, research paper, research reports and presentation. My result and discussion, agriculture growth in India. India has made a lot of progress in the agriculture after mid-60s in the terms of growth in output yield area and under many crops. It has gone through the successful revolution, wise the green revolution, white revolution, yellow revolution and blue revolution. The main source of long-run growth was technological augmentation of yield per unit of crop area. The agriculture growth in India during 1970 and early 80s was propelled by the green revolution technology. But the productivity gain from green revolution technology in India have essentially ended. Growth in agriculture after mid-90s was totally different than before mid-90s, mainly because of three continuous climatically abnormal year at the end of 90s. The purchase input-based crop production and protection system did not yield expected proportionate increase in production, as per the study of Kamalkar in 2011. Table 1 shows the production of food grain and commercial crop in India. As we see that in 1950s, the share of cereal, pulses, food grain and oilseeds, cotton were very lower than in recent year like 2013-14, 14-15, 15-16, 16-17, 17-18, and it was now in 18-19, it is rice that is 115.60 million ton, wheat that is 99.12 million ton, corn that is 42.64 million ton. Whereas total we see in 1950 it was 42.42, whereas in 1819 it was 257 million ton. Similarly, when we see the pulses data, in 50-51 it was only 8.41, whereas in 1819 it was 24. In food grain, there is increase in production. In 50-51 it was only 50 million ton, whereas in 1819 it was 281. And oilseed production also increased from 5 million ton to 31 million ton respective year. Similarly, in cotton, in 50-51, 3 million bales, and in 18-19, it was 34.86 million bales. Table 2 shows the growth rate in the agriculture industry and service in India. The growth of agriculture, the rate of agriculture in terms of percentage per annum, in 60-61, it was 4% in agriculture, which is increased in 1450 to 1782%, 0.55. Whereas industry, it was in 60-61, 68, it was 5%, whereas in 14-15, 17-18, it was 7%. And service sector, that is 5%, which were increased 8%. So agriculture growth rate was only 1% per annum in 60s decade as per the table, and other period growth rate was range from 2.5 0.2% to 2.7% per annum. The post-reform period growth rate service was month more than 8% per annum. And industry recorded 7 to 8% during 2004-5, 17-18. The highest growth rate of GDP from agriculture was 3.7% per annum in 2004-5, 13-14. The growth rate in agriculture in the period 2009-10 to 13-14 was 4.3% per annum. This is one of the highest growth rate recorded in independent India. The growth rate of agriculture GDP was 2.5% per annum is the last 4-year period, that is 14-15 to 17-18. Though the share of agriculture in India, Indian economy has progressively declined to 17% to the country's gross value added for the year 2016-17 due to the highest growth rate of the industry and services. Yes, sir.
Please listen. Vandana, you have any other table to show?
Yes, sir. The changes.
Show the tables. Show the tables, and then come to the conclusion. Yeah?
Okay, sir. These graphs, this figure shows that the changes in the cropping pattern in India, that as the share of oilseeds, when we see in 60-61, it was only 1%, wherein 16-17, it was 13%. So the similarly cotton share also increased from 5 to 6%. Other crops share decreased from 17 to 14, whereas the total cereal share also decreased from 60 to 50. So this shows that how the cropping pattern changed in the India. Here I also have a table for agriculture growth in Gujarat. This table shows the percentage wise crops percentage growth rate in percentage and trend random years, that is in 1972-73, 1883, the value of output is 3.64% in 72-73, 82-83, whereas in 2010-11, 2014-15 it was 8.12%, and land productivity, that is 3.67%, whereas it was also increased 7.78%. Here also one table four represent the productivity in kilogram hectare trend in major crops of Gujarat. That is also trend and these are the major crops: rice, wheat, jowar, bajra, maize, arhar, groundnut, sugar cane and cotton. We see that in the 82-83, it was 1,335 productivity of rice, and 14-15, it was increased to 1,902. Similarly, in productivity of wheat also increased.
Come to the conclusion, please.
Yes, sir. Sir, I have also one table, agriculture development from in the Gujarat.
If there is any particular table on the diversification, I would like to see.
Sir, this table number 6 shows the changes in cropping pattern in Gujarat in 2072-73 to 2014-15, and this shows that the some of the commercial crops have changed. See, in oil seeds, that is 21%, and oil seeds in 14-15, 23%. Similarly, cotton seeds, 19%, which is decreased to 18%. And other spices, 0%, which is increased to 4%. So, like this table shows how the cropping pattern changes in the Gujarat.
Okay. Come to the conclusion.
And these graph, these figures show the major changes occur in the cropping pattern, where we see the all pulses in 72-73, that is less, but now it is increased. Similarly, in sugarcane, it is decreased, but it is increased in 2014-15. Similarly, in other crops also, there is increase in productivity in the 2014-15. So this figure is also shows that there is a changes in cropping pattern in Gujarat. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So my conclusion is that it is well proved that new agriculture, new and improved technology help India to achieve substantial determined food production in the shorter period. The Gujarat is the one of the fastest growing economy. Gujarat agriculture has shows a large change. There is a changes occur in the last 3 decades. It's revealed that the agriculture production of the major commercial crop over a period of time is increased. And this is after 2000, it is continuously increased because of the irrigation, electrification, research and fertilizer consumption. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Vandana, you have really presented a good paper on the crop diversification. Some points I would discuss with you later on. But first of all, I think now this particular session is open for the discussion.
Vandana, stop sharing your screen.
Yeah.
Stop share.
Sir, product yes, sir, of sugar yes, as shown in table is 7,400. Is it correct or need some correction?
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Productivity of sugarcane is shown in the table is 7,422 kg per hectare.
Mm-hmm. Sir, my slide is visible.
Yeah, I have seen it.
Okay, but right now, yes.
So, I think it needs correction. Is it correct or productivity of sugarcane?
Productivity of sugarcane for India?
Yeah, you have shown 7,422 kg per hectare. Is it correct?
7,000.
Yes, sir. For 80, sir, that is a try and end in 3 years average data.
Hello? It should be something.
Per hectare or per acre?
Yeah, shown it is per hectare. Per but acre. It is some misleading. The figures are misleading.
Some typing error.
It ranged from 80 tons per hectare, something.
Sir, for so, this is, yes.
One digit, hello? One digit is missing there.
Okay. I will check, sir. I will check
Yes. Yeah, you have to correct all for all periods.
Okay, sir. Sure.
It is shown in the range of 7,000 kg per hectare. It should be more than that because it ranges from 70 to 80 tons like this in India.
Yes, sir. I will check my paper.
Check.
Correct it.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other?
Dr. Mahajan, can I ask something?
Yes.
So I have two little queries for Prasanna and Sarita. Prasanna, are you there? Prasanna? Sarita?
I think both have left.
Sarita? Prasanna?
I think they have left.
Okay, sir. Please continue. It's okay. Thank you.
Any other query or supplement or anything you want to ask to the paper presenter? I think there is no query at all. In the conclusion, let I take into consideration my view for those particular papers which I have actually listened, and I would request Professor Tour, he would give something for these 4-5 papers which he has listened. Now, first of all, I feel that I have listened 8 papers, and in 8 papers, what I feel that most of the papers, they are from the empirical study. Now, if you take into consideration the cost tons and analysis of okra production in Balod district of Chhattisgarh, it is presented by Yogeshwari Sahu. What is significant in the same that there is no difference between the small marginal and large farmer cost and return analysis. All empirical research is showing that it is approximately 1.6 return. That is, 1 rupees is the cost, 1.6 is the return of the same. And it is almost the same. That is, in one case it is 1.58, in other case it is 1.59, and in other case it is 1.6. So you see, this type of situation must be checked, that why it is so, and if there is a valid reason for the same, then it would be a fruitful study. Now, if you take into consideration, let it be the recent paper which is presented by Vandana Pawar. So what I want to say that if she gives the growth rate and all these type of things, she must be in a position to relate it with the agriculture. For example, agriculture growth and crop diversification is the topic, and there must be a correlation between the two, and that correlation must be presented in a very well fashion. Now, you see, there are certain type of index which can better show whether there is a crop diversification or not. For example, there is a Harfinder index is there, which can easily show that which way the crop diversification has been there. Moreover, I will tell you, there is a decomposition analysis which can be taken into consideration, because that would show that what are the basic composition factors which actually take or make the crop diversification possible. Now, regarding this Priyanka Sharma's technical part, I could not listen it properly, but anywho, this was a paper which actually has not based upon the secondary data or the, you can say, any primary data, but most of the conclusions are that it should be done like this or that. When we take into consideration this analysis of land use pattern, as the now consumption pattern changes, which was presented by Babita Kathyar. Now, this is a good paper, and she has taken into consideration that with the growth of income, there has been actually decrease in the cereal consumption. And I think this is a universal type of conclusion, but she should add that why these type of changes have been there in that particular case. So if you take into consideration the this paper, Socioeconomic and Value Chain Analysis of Goat Farming, it's a good paper presented by Narendra Singh. He has actually given the conclusion that goat farming can supplement the income and can double the income of the farmer, as it is perceived by the, our national policy. And at the same time, the Yojana Ayog has also actually emphasized that by adopting some of the supplement type of occupation, the farmers can increase the... Now, Narendra Singh could better, justify this particular fact if he has taken into consideration the mixed farming, because mixed is a part of the mixed farming where we can have or integrated farming also, where we have actually a small piece of land as well as the livestock range can also help the same. So there is also a good paper presented by Surbhi Bansal. Surbhi Bansal has taken into consideration the cost and return structure of the tenant farmer into consideration. Now, there has been a very significant difference between the cost and return of the tenant farmer. I think something more should be done so that it should be very clear that why this type of has differences has occurred in the same. So these were my observations for the 8 papers which I have listened, and 4 papers have been listed by my co-chairperson, Dr. Jasdeep Singh Tur. I would request him that he should also pass some type of analysis of the four papers which you have selected.
Sir, I had discussed the things right after the completion of the paper, so it's over from me now. I had discussed the things earlier.
So, should I conclude the session?
Yes, sir. Yes, it's over now. Presenter was absent.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm thankful to the organizer of this webinar. Now I'm very thankful to the head of the department, Professor Tewana, of the Punjab University Economics Department. Those who have given me the opportunity to be the chairman of this particular session. I'm also thankful to my co-chair, Dr. Jasdeep Tooth, who has really cooperated me and actually taken into consideration the technical snag as well as listened carefully to the paper. I'm also thankful to the reporter report, Ms. Palvinder Kaur. Thank you very much. Thank you all the participants also. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Goodbye to all the participants from Punjabi University Patiala, and on behalf of Department of Economics, Punjabi University Patiala, I thank all the participants who are here and shared their valuable observations on different topics. So thank you very much. Thank you.
Hello.
Yes. Okay, sir. Okay. Goodbye.
Hello.